Hey, the baby.
Hotep community, yep. Welcome back to the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. I hope that you are safe and sound and in your right state of mind wherever you are. Back with us again is our beautiful brother, Baba Kaba Hiawatha Kamene. But we've got a really spectacular brother with us tonight. When Kaba was talking about, you know, when he always asked, what are we going to do? How do we prepare ourselves for the future? I got an opportunity to work with a brother named Julian Carroll, who is an unequivocal expert on electric vehicles, but particularly electric vehicles that work for Black folks, so for the African-American community. And so we're going to go in deep and really help move the family forward tonight in this conversation. And the brother has a new book out, as well as a free e-course, PowerPointed video e-course that is absolutely amazing. There's technology that we need to be in. There are vehicles that are designed that we should be knowing about. And in fact, when we get into the conversation, we were just talking in the green room that, you know, Biden is all of these new green deals and all of this motored, you know, cars with motors and mufflers, that's gone. So you've got to learn how to live in this new environment. So that being said, welcome Julian Carroll and Kaba Hiawatha Kamene.
Hey, Hotep, my brothers and sisters, and, you know, peace be upon you, and hope your families are doing well during this time. And make sure you keep that 5150 straight jacket off you. You know, give up a bunch of love, hug each other if you can, because they took that away from us with COVID. They slick. So, you know, share the love wherever you can give it. We need it all.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You doing all okay over there, Bobby, with that snowstorm?
It's all good.
Gotcha.
It's all good. We're doing what we got to do. And it was a very warm day today here in New York. And, it, you know, it was over 40 degrees. And it just brought, you know, it melted down a lot of what was here. So we're handling this, brother.
Fantastic. Fantastic. I see you out there, Family Coyote Prophet. I see you out there, Terry Campbell, Black Community, Black Ward. I see Brian Bino, my brother from another mother. Gerard, I see you out there. Y'all ain't playing. Y'all serious out here in these internet streets. Now, Brother Julian, let's talk about first, give us a little bit of background on where you come from and why you started doing all this research on electric vehicles and charging stations. And you kind of, you're a futurist, in my opinion. You kind of saw something coming that we need to be ready for. What, talk to me about that, and how did you get into this?
Well, basically, you know, I'm a city planner, environmental planner, and bicycle planning engineering expert. I worked for the California Department of Transportation as a chief planner. I ran seven districts. So that was from Oregon to Mexico. So I put in bike trails, bridges, all kinds of things that deal with transportation. And so through that, I dealt with every aspect of transportation. So I can basically build your whole city, put you a rail network in it, a transportation network in it, whatever futuristic, you know, whatever you need in transportation, I can do that. And through my studies, as I was getting ready to retire, I saw that electric cars was coming into play. Mm-hmm. And Caltrans, they research and study everything, autonomous vehicles, so AI vehicles. So I knew all about all that. So I went and did some research. And what happened was a good friend of mine, Greg Bridges, had a lady friend who worked for a green company, electric company. And she asked him, do you know anybody would want to get a job in this type of field? Mm-hmm. So it was an electric company with a brother and a white guy. They was blended. They were like family, and they had a small electric company. So she hooked me up with an interview. And this is deep. So Kaba can tell you this. When somebody hook you up with something, you have to be there and be ready. Okay. Mm-hmm. You can't mess up someone's name. Mm-hmm. It's their name they're putting out there for you. So you have to go and abide by the rules that was set by them. Mm-hmm. Don't mess them up. So I go to the interview, man. I sat there. It was 10 o'clock meeting. It's 10, 11, 12, 1, 2. Brother, nobody showed up. So the brother came in about 3 o'clock and he said, brother, I'm sorry you waited this long or whatever. I say, well, somebody set the interview up and I didn't want to leave so you can say to them that the person wasn't interested. So he said, well, just come. I'm going to give a talk and come on in. So long story short, he gave his talk about these new charging stations. The brother had vision. He said, it's going to be this day, this way and that way. I said, I know this. This brother got something going. So I talked to him about it and he saw my resume. He said, brother, I could use you, but you're not an electrician and I can't really do nothing with you. I said, well, yes, you can. Let me figure out how we can partner some kind of way. So long story short, they hooked me into the electrical vehicle charging station. So I convinced them. I used to run a building department and planning department. Let me run your building permits and y'all can show me how to do the inspections because I studied electronics. Just show me and I'll pick it up. So that's what I did. So they had a project with the first projects in Silicon Valley, BMW, Ford, Volkswagen. So we were putting in all these charging stations in these basically high-end executives from Silicon Valley that was down in Los Altos Hills, Sunnyville, all those places. And so I was like, wow, this is going to be big. So once the contract was up, I delivered about 40 of them for them. So I started doing research. And then by working at the state came out with this electric improvement program where they wanted to deploy and install thousands of charging stations. Mm-hmm. So I started to do the research because I'm a researcher. Mm-hmm. I have a research company dealing with solar. So as I started dealing with solar, I looked at Japan and they were putting electric cars and solar together. And so I had these ideas way before Elon Musk. He wasn't even on the deal yet. Mm-hmm. But I didn't have Elon money, nor did I have something Elon has like you men have, is supporters. Mm-hmm. So when you take this to brothers and sisters, because I know a lot of genius brothers. Okay, engineer, let's connect. This is something we got here. No, man. Okay, cool. I'm going to do this myself. So I just went on and did the research and went up to Sacramento. They had a meeting of 10 years ago of how they were going to deploy these stations. So could you imagine a brother walking in here, all these cats, you know, big time white dudes, car owners, manufacturers, stuff. So I broke it down to them. Y'all playing games. You know, the car dealerships is sabotaging the electrical car because they got a good business model with gas cars. Mm-hmm. Y'all ain't never getting nothing done. They looking at me like I'm crazy. You know, I'm not crazy. I'm an expert in this area. I can speak on all of this. Okay. So once I gave that speech, it's on record of how they should deploy all these systems. So I went back to the drawing board and decided to create something for myself. Mm. What I've been doing. And my daughter had a baby. So I told her I had to watch the baby. So I was going to a school with these Latino sisters over in Oakland, Spanish Unity Council, beautiful sisters. They taught me how to run a business. So I got to keeping the baby and I just said, oh, okay, this got to go back because I can't watch the baby and do all this. So then that's when I saw your show and saw, I said, wow, this brother got great vibration. Let me see what this is about. So then you start teaching the history, which is what I'm about. Mm-hmm. I gave up TV at 13. Okay. Mm-hmm. Deal with that. I just read books and had my music. That's all. Because my parents were strict and we couldn't do much but shoot hoop, study books, and work. So that was cool because we had a great home. So I just got into it, man. I built it. And when you talked to me about it, you said, well, why don't you write a book for our people? Mm-hmm. And I said, good. And so I put in my energy to do that and put a lot into it. And you carried me all the way through. And I want to say thank you for that because we need to know about technology and transportation.
Absolutely.
Transportation has been the number one killer of our businesses, mm-hmm. the number one killers of our communities.
Okay? See, one of the things, Brother Julian, that I love about your work and what you do, your energy, your tenacity and temerity, is that Kaba has been always drilling in us that what happens when the birth dearth occurs? What happens when they're not here? What are you going to do? We need people who know how to build transportation systems. We need people to know how to move into and take advantage of this new technology. This is what's getting ready to happen. And I talked about this at least 5 years ago on the show. And I remember saying that one of the first things that was going to become extinct is the transportation system that we know of today. People who drive trucks, gone. It's going to be automated. People who are working in automotive industries, gone, because it's electric. Completely different science. So it's going to be analogous to what happened when CDs took over cassette tapes. Mm-hmm. You remember that transition? And then it's like you were in the CD mode, and it's like, and then all of a sudden CDs went digital. It's like, wait a minute. This is, there's a concept in technology called controlled obsolescence. Mm-hmm. And you'll correct me if I don't have the understanding of it, Julian, and that is, you know how you might buy a computer or some type of electronic device, and it only has a shelf life of 2, maybe 3, 4 years, and then after that it just stops working. But whereas you remember back in the day when we used to buy Kenmore appliances, and they would last until you would be dead and pass it on to your grandkids or to your children or whatever. They don't make that no more because they're saying we're losing money. We've got to create something that breaks after a certain time so we can have the new device in. Is that about accurate, Brother Julian?
Yeah, yes, it is, because, you know, also you have to add the human quality in there. Okay, the craftsmanship. See, people had craftsmanship. They was raised and taught to have believe in their work. See, I was taught that the work you put out is your imprint. This is what you're showing to the world, and you're absolutely correct. That's why it goes obsolete. It's no different than you have a digital versus analog. Okay, mm-hmm.
Analog. What are your thoughts, Kaba? I know you are. Beautiful. This is your domain, bro, because you have been talking about this for so long. Finally got a brother who actually, you know, has that kind of foresight and vision and process for us. What are your thoughts on this, Brother Baba Kaba?
Well, you know, first, Brother Julian, it is truly a pleasure and an honor to speak with you.
Thank you.
About this subject, because as Brother Philippe said, this is the last chapter in my book, Spirituality Before Religion. This is what I'm talking about. I don't have the expertise, but I do have an understanding. And the reality is, I often say the future wealth of the planet is in solar power. That's the future wealth. We are going to get up off the earth. We're going to get up off of fossil fuels eventually. Right now, we're still in between all of this. And the electric aspect of this is going to be a very important part. I'm doing research right now on China, who has now produced a train.
Yes, I saw
that. That is moving on. And Philippe, how many times we talked about this? On magnetism.
All the time.
Moving on magnetism. Okay, and magnetism is a female energy, and electricity is a male energy. The advantage that our ancestors had was that because they were so close to nature, they were able to take this information in and apply it to those things that were around them, because economy, as I've said, has nothing to do with money. Economy. Echo comes from the word oikos. It's a Greek word, but it's African, but I'm going to leave that for another day. But oikos means environment or home. So economy is to know your environment and to be able to utilize it in the best interest of yourself, your community, and everyone else around you. It had nothing to do with money. No. In fact, a lot of things that we buy with money is exactly to be able to do something for our home. So we're still in that mode.
Yes.
But what I also wanted to hook this into school, because I see that there are folk on the chat that are talking about how we have to bring this into our schools.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
As a social science background, as I've studied the development of civilizations, one of the first things you look for when you are about to build a city or anything else as it relates to a nation, the first thing you look for is your water source. Water is one of the most important things.
70%.
That you look for right. In terms of your city. Because if you don't have a water source, your city gonna have problems.
Big ones.
The other piece is the fact that every civilization from the Twa Mbuti, the very first original family in Central South Africa,
absolutely,
to this very day, every civilization advanced itself because of transportation and communication.
Absolutely.
That's what moves the society forward.
Absolutely.
And there's a brother that I work with, name is David Head. Mm-hmm. He wrote a book on Granville T. Woods. He used to work for MTA here in New York.
Mm.
He wrote a book on Granville T. Woods.
The brother.
That's it. And you got to understand, Granville T. Woods and Edison and, those barons, so-called, was trying to steal stuff from Woods all the time. He was taking them to court all the time back in the early 1900s.
Mm.
Because of his inventions. What he basically developed, fundamentally, was for the trains in particular to be able to move at a certain pace.
Right.
And not only that, but he perfected the communication department in the sub, so that when today's train man or train woman is talking to headquarters, that was invented by Granville T. Woods.
Yes, it was.
Mm-hmm.
And the movement of the trains. Not only that, but he really is the father of Coney Island's roller coaster. He was the one that created tracks to be able to move certain things. So movement becomes very important because every civilization has products. They create something. There's a supply, there's a demand.
Right.
When you are developing your supply and demand chain, it becomes very important for you to be able to communicate with the buyer. It's also important to get your product to the buyer.
Mm-hmm.
So you have communications and transportation. The better you can communicate, the better orders you get. But that means nothing if the twin transportation isn't put in place to be able to get that product to the buyer.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that when you're looking at what the future is, they're not going to have to tell you because you black, you ain't going to get this job.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not in it, you ain't going to win it.
Mm-hmm.
No,
and sometimes you have to, because I tell people all the time, I'm the spook who sat by the classroom door. I was deep inside that education system so that I could come back to the community to be able to speak to them on what I saw actually happen.
Right.
And right. So what Brother Carroll has done in developing his book and his e-course, I hope you don't mind me saying this, but he the brother that he the spook that sat by the transportation door and learned 100%. What he had to learn in order to come back to us, because remember, we already have had our own car company.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not like this is just brand new that we got to start in a place we've never been before. Not only did we have,
we also have car companies in Africa too. We have top notch, high end car companies.
Africa. Nigeria is coming out. Ghana's
yes.
On airplanes, transportation and communication are the two areas that catapult civilizations into the next level. That's also what transports human beings to the next level of consciousness.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
How you move and how you talk.
Mm-hmm.
Transportation and communication. This is what I used to teach my sixth graders, my fifth graders. And it becomes important that we teach to the inventor's mind.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Not just teaching math, not just teaching this. What Brother Carroll is offering us is not just to know this. It's to understand electricity.
Mm-hmm.
You see, everybody talking about 4G and 5G. I'm talking about Raji. Raji has no numbers to it.
Go ahead. Go ahead, brother.
It is eternal. It is immortal.
Put it down.
It is like a loving mother who wants to give her child all the sustenance and nurturing that child can get to become a great person.
Exactly.
And you know what's also interesting, Brother Carroll? Isn't it interesting how every place where the sun shines the brightest, the people are the most melanated?
Yes, they are.
Isn't it like the ancestors and the creator just placed the wealth in our backyard? We don't even have to go downtown.
Monroe wrote a song about it, Groovy People.
Yeah, I like that one. Groovy People.
Right.
So, gentlemen, let me ask you this. Let me ask you this because, and I don't want to sound like Boyce Watkins, but one of the things that I see with this industry also is for the family not only to prepare themselves for this new electric transportation world that we're going to be in, but doesn't it make sense for the family to look at what are the companies? What are the associated companies that are in this field that you can start investing in right now? Because it's going to be here for another 20, 30, 40, 50 years. So the best way to predict the future, family, is to create it. Remember, we talked about in this consciousness of first frequency, collapsing time. When they stole us, they stole our time. We got frozen in time. This is the way of getting our time back. And getting control of our time so we don't end up running out of time. You've got to, as we do Sankofa, going back to come forward, we also have to do what Baba Kaba says, and that is take a boomerang so that, and go back so we can project ourselves forward and then come back. We are timeless people. So this is a very, very real sense. If you learn how to predict what industries are coming, where is everything going, then you can be there before it happens. And that's almost, that's a sentient being, right? I remember my Kung Fu instructor used to say, block before the punch is thrown.
Right.
And so, Julian, talk to us about that aspect of this.
Well,
what I'm saying?
Yeah, I dig that because that's a part of the book. And like Kaba said, he used one of the words I use, it's called utilization, utilize. Like I tell people, utilize your parents, utilize your friends, your network. Don't use them. Okay.
Mm.
So the beauty of this is what you're saying. The book is about that. It's not just about owning an electric car or buying a charging station. It's about our people getting involved in every aspect of that car.
Mm-hmm.
The battery, the e-technology and the powertrain, the materials that go into the battery, the materials that make the cars. All of these companies are going to blow up.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't want to get an electric car, then invest in the technology.
Right.
Invest in the battery technology. Invest in the car technology. Invest in public and private utility companies, which are electric companies. They're going to put up the power plants. They're going to put up the microgrids. They're going to put up the solar. Okay. All of this is combined. Like the brother said, he named off one brother. That's one brother, okay? You got Frederick McKinley, the brother who created all the combustible engines and all the electronics that go in a car. You got Elijah McCoy, who created the refrigeration, the oil of the wheels, the tracking, everything. So these three brothers right there, Granville, Frederick, and Elijah, you wouldn't have transportation, okay?
Mm-hmm.
The refrigeration of cars, okay? We call that multimodal now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That was the part of when George Bush Sr., he did a crazy stuff, but he did one good thing. He created the Inner Surface Modal Transportation Act called ICE-T, which was put together by a brother named Rodney Slater. He was the head of the United States Department of Transportation. And they implemented all of this. And I had to go to these meetings with all these top white men. Like he said, spooked by the dough, they sent me. And I knew what was up. And I came back and wrote a position paper telling it's no more business as usual. The way we deal with transportation in America has changed.
Mm-hmm.
I went to Europe to see how it was. So you're looking at bicycles, pedestrians. Now you got electric scooters, electric bikes. Trains, cars, light rail, heavy rail, inner city rail. Then you got your ports. You got your waterways coming along. Okay, your boats, your ships, your tugboats, all of that is included in transportation. It's called the movement of people, goods, and services. Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. transportation. And yeah. that's where we are now with our people. By getting into these electric cars, we can change our lives. Mm-hmm. One, they're low frequency engines, which heals our body.
Talk to me about that, bro. Because when we talked on the phone, or not on the phone, when we were doing our Zoom meeting, going back and forth and everything, one of the PowerPoint presentations that you did in the e-course was talking about that. I'm like, what? You know, that piqued my ears, man. I was like, talk to me about how the electric car and the electric industry can assist us in our own first frequency.
Well, the car, when you drive it, see, that's the key. The car calms your nerves. That's why it's a low frequency. It's quiet. You can't hear it. Mm. It's like a dog. A dog has so many cycles per second, and a human has so many cycles per second. Okay? We're going to only hear certain things. And through hearing, transferring to your brain waves, in which is your frequencies, are going to be altered. So you can drive in a car that basically can put you to sleep if you're tired. Mm. Because the frequency is low. You don't hear rah, 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 rah. You don't hear the rambunction of the combustion engine. You just hear. It's like wind. Those are frequencies. Different changes in the wind can hurt your ears. You ever been on the beach and your ears start hurting? That's the frequency. Those are changes. So this is what the electric car can do for us. It can also not only help our budget, because the book is about cost recovery, recovering the cost that you spend on something, which is what the electric car and everything involved in it can do for you. This is our opportunity to drive a car that don't break down all the time. This is a car where you don't have to borrow $20 or $5 to get you and your kids to school or to grocery school. You can charge in your home. This is a car that you can take and make money. You can go pick up your elderly neighbors and take them shopping and take them to the hospital, because you don't need to go get no gas. You charge 2 hours in your home, you have full charge. That person is only going to drive 50 miles a day to work and back, or stores or whatever. See, when transportation, we call them trip generators. Trip going to generate, okay? Then you come up with a model with through those trip generations of how people are actually going to move themselves, like the brother was saying, magnetic left, okay? Magnetic left, you can go 200 miles an hour, 1,000 miles an hour, and you won't even hit a train.
Yeah, well, the what I think what Cabo was talking about with the one inch and man, I saw that video. It was on, I think it was on CNN or something. Man, it was crazy, because it's like you're sitting up in your living room, and you're going, I think like 500 miles an hour or some.
Absolutely.
It's at the same speed of a plane.
Yeah.
The speed of a train. Okay. And they did something, because I think it has windows. I'm not sure, but they did something, because there's something happens, I guess, when you start seeing yourself moving that fast. It could probably cause some type of motion sickness of some sort. So, yeah, and so, but the thing would go, like, from New York to California on a train in the same time, that in less time, actually, that it would take a plane to do that, going with the wind, with the crosswind. It was insane to me they're literally building this. This is not this is not hypothesis. This is going to be the future. So in the next 20 years, we're going to see this happening in real time. What are we going to do to be there? How are we going to take advantage and steal our time back, collapse our time back, and be there before the punch is thrown?
I agree. Kaba?
Well, you know, what I just like to offer, because this is my concept. The book that I, you know, that I read that I felt was very interesting was written by Dr. Michio Kaku. It's called The Physics of the Future. And he talks about maglev, which is magnetic levitation.
Right.
And basically what you're dealing with is, imagine being on slick, pure ice. And you have managed, like, for instance, being on certain tracks, that you are going to stay in a particular place.
Mm-hmm.
If you go back to Star Wars, if you remember how those cars ran just above the ground, but they moved across.
Magnolorian. So okay. Yeah.
See, this is the concept that you could go, all you'd have to do is just push it and it would move.
Right.
It could go from New York to California without stopping. But just think of terms of being slick ice, and you have something that's on top that's being guided across it. You don't need the energy to push it, because it's on its own, delving with that concept.
Maglev.
It's magnetic levitation. This is reality. But hold on a minute and let me bring it back. You talk about time, space, continuum. Let me tell you about how we consider possibly those huge stones were moved in Egypt to create the pyramids.
Exactly.
Because there are friezes that will show you that our ancestors in this particular picture, in the frieze carved on the wall, there's someone in the front that looks like he's pouring, or she is pouring, a liquid.
Mm.
It is believed from my research that when you pour that, that makes the sand hardened. You know, like when it rains on the beach and the sand is hard, and then the sun comes out and then it breaks up again into the individual pieces of sand.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, this liquid solidified the sand that in many ways could have had the attributes of maglev that would have allowed them to be able to push these ton bricks, these huge tons of bricks across the sand. Levitation. So what I'm trying to say is that this concept is not far. And also, in the back of this particular picture or frieze, you had someone else pouring another liquid, which symbolized them returning the sand back to the consistency of sand. You know, we did this in the 18th dynasty for the Kemetic Wisdom School, where I showed the actual frieze where you see them moving this statue. This huge statue. How could they move it across the sand? Well, they could convert the sand into something that could make it like ice. And then it's just a matter of pushing it across. Nothing is new under the sun.
No,
it's our not. Ancestors did it back then. No, it's just that it's being corrupted, because what Brother Carroll is saying, ain't no car company want this. Con Ed.
No,
there's a reason why they call Con Ed, and they say consolidated, but it's really a con, because everything that could light your house, cook your food, drive your car, everything you do because of Raji could be free.
Yeah, right. You know, think about this. Like I said, I've been studying the temples, okay? Look at Solomon's temple, which is every house is built off that. Bowls and gaze, two pillars, the Maat, you enter them. Okay, now the whole thing, and Kaba could tell you this, the Israels and all that, the Jews, and they tripping off this, they're in the wrong spot, okay? They're in Jerusalem. The spot is Mount Zion, okay? The spot is Mount Zion. So when you look at the temple, the construction of it, the limestone, like I was telling you about that statue my grandfather built, he couldn't build it. He told him, you let me build it to stand, because he used lime, what you think is in them pyramids, lime. Okay. Now, Solomon's temple had to be prefabricated. So what the Dr. Cobb is saying is relevant. It had to be prefabricated. You can read it in the Bible. No metal tools, no nothing on site can be a part of this building. Okay, China has mastered it through Wuhan. That's why Wuhan is so important. Wuhan is the international metallurgy, the development of the world, because they copied everything that Britain and the United States did and made it better.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? They can put a bridge up in a week. They can put a hospital up in days.
Which they did. You saw that happening when COVID hit.
I study it. Yeah. Because the prefabrication of Solomon's temple was the first part of that. The whole structure had to be prefabbed before it was brought to the site.
Mm-hmm.
How did that happen? That's what Kaba's explaining. How did they move these massive stones to this site? No one could figure that out. For example, the Japanese tried to build the pyramids in Giza. They collapsed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? They weren't just using pi. They was using 6 times pi.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's like when I first got tuned in the Kaba, that's what got me going. The Wachichuchu people and their mounds. The mound cable stayed 60. You put cable stayed 60 in the pyramid, it's the same dimension.
Mm.
Octagon, hexagon is going to be the same. Cable stayed. The hypotenuse, which is the pyramid, same thing. Cable stayed 60 degrees. So, you know, geography is the key to all of it.
Mm-hmm.
See, I'm an earth scientist. I'm a geographer. And I'll pull out the globe on you in a minute and show you what went down. That's how you're going to relate to the earth's surface. Okay? Where you sitting at right now, where I'm sitting at now, we're 90 degrees perpendicular to the sun. We're the abacus. That's what you see all over, right? 90, you keep going around, you're going to get 360.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we're talking about, the Earth's rotation. How are we using gravitational force to move things? Maglev, electric motors, okay? Steamships, okay? High-speed rail. We talk when in transportation, you talk headways. How long is it going to take a bus to get to you? Is it 15 minutes? Is it 20 minutes? China, they got 5-minute headways. Japan, they got 5-minute headways. A high-speed train is going to be at that stop in 5 minutes every 5 minutes because they're going 200 miles an hour.
Now, let me ask you this, Brother Carroll.
Yes, sir.
When some people might be listening right now or will be listening to this broadcast, and they'll say, well, I don't have a house or home where I can plug this thing, plug my car in. What about people who live in apartments or condominiums and situations like that? How can they get access to this if they decide to get an electric vehicle?
Okay, well, now you have an emphasis on multifamily dwellings to add in electric charging stations because net zero energy now. Every building, because I'm a builder, city planner, every building in the United States is going to have to be net zero energy. So that means you're going to have to put different R levels of insulation in your home. You have to put double pane windows. You're going to have to use type of materials that insulate the home that, you know, traps energy where you can put it back to the grid. Things like that is what is what's going to answer that.
Fantastic.
And you know, the other thing that I just want to add to what Brother Carroll and the question you had, Brother Philippe, is that we all going to get electric.
Yes.
You know, just like we all going to get CD and DVD, just like eventually we're going to be streaming. We're going to get it. I think what Brother Carroll is talking about, let's be on the front end of this.
Right.
But because you're going to go electric. That's the future.
So nothing you can do about it.
You know, it's like trying to keep playing your video cassette, even though ain't nobody selling video cassette machines.
Yeah, but and also, Kaba, going back to his question, it's going to require innovation. See, I work with city planning. That's going to require that new building codes be revisited.
Mm-hmm,
see,
mm-hmm.
You can put electric charging station as a parking meter. Okay, you got to be creative. You live in an apartment, you can put it outside an apartment on the sidewalk where they can charge at night where they park, or you can put it in the driveway where they park because everyone don't have an enclosed facility.
It's going to happen.
Oh, it's happening now.
It's happening as we speak, to tell you the truth. But the idea of finding portable ones, ones that sometimes could be in a suitcase, could be like the size of an attaché case, because energy is so powerful, you don't need nothing real big. This is the other thing. We think because there's so much energy and power, we need big things. That's not how energy works. Look at this. Look at the phones that we have now. Remember what the phones actually look like? And now they're connecting the camera, this, the internet, everything can fit in this. I mean, my library is in this now. I don't even buy physical books because, so you don't need big things to get big things.
No, man. You're so right, because they got a spherical rod about like this in Japan that could produce energy for a whole neighborhood.
Yeah.
So it's all kind of technologies beyond this. Think about, add this to it. Transportation. Look at Elon Musk. He already got a space loop. He's trying to put California trying to put in a high speed rail now, like Japan, Taiwan, the Netherlands, Germany. Okay, but Elon Musk got a loop that he's losing a magnetic levitation to loop you through. He can get you to LA in 4 hours, but a loop.
Wow.
He got SpaceX. He taking you to the moon. And what Gil said, the people, when you get out, you ain't looking for their land, okay? Wow. He doing that now. You can jump out and have a wine cooler, okay? Riding to Mars or whatever. See, that's a part of transportation. Mm-hmm. We in the Jetson age, okay? We in the Jetsons.
Real talk. Real talk. Okay. It's facts, yeah.
Well, America's in the Flintstones.
Yes, definitely. And, you know, like Chicago. Chicago got a city plan where they're going to have edible gardens. They're going to have magnetic cars, okay? They're already way ahead, okay? Yeah. 2040, they're looking to implement this, okay? Silent streetcars. Electricity is happening now. Everything is moving to clean energy. Biden just said that he's going to make all the federal cars electric cars, okay? So that's businesses for us. What are we waiting for? Like Kaba said, we're going to have to get one. You're going to have to get one. So why not start now while they have all the incentives to get you money back?
And that's let's talk about money, baby. Let's do that. Let's talk about more money, more money, more money, which I love. That's what the book is about. You have slipped. I mean, it's like you scraped the internet and scraped all of this information, man, of how we can literally save money, not by just the obvious, like, okay, I don't have to pay for gas, right? That's one part. But there are other ways that going electric saves you ridiculous amounts of money.
Yes, it does. And the way it's set up now, because of the deployment of the charging stations and the employment and the advancement of the electrical vehicle and the motors, the technology, the powertrains, that, you know, they can get speeds up to what combustible engines can do and even more. Plus, the automotive industry committed to this 20 years ago that they was going to get rid of gas cars. They didn't tell the public that. So now it's time to get busy for us. These cars, start building these cars, start getting, applying for jobs, like Kaba said, with Tesla, Ford, GM. All these people going to be building cars now. Okay? It's about transportation technology that's efficient and lowering the carbon footprint of the world. That's what time it is. So why should we wait before they bars? Like, if you didn't come along, I couldn't have gotten this book out. I couldn't even got in the game. Now with this book, they can't stop me in the game. Okay. Because when I first wrote the book, everybody said to me, well, why are you writing it for African-American people? Man, who talking to us about this?
Right.
Okay, I'm a brother. I'm an expert. I can't even get in the dough. CEOs ask me questions, but they ain't going to hire me for their company because they think I know more than them. So you gotta be a spook who sat by the door to even get in, okay? Not anymore. Brothers like you, brothers like Kaba, you know, resourceful men, resourceful women, resourceful people. Let's get everybody involved in this. We got sisters that's dynamic engineers in technology. I want some of them to design some electric cars. I want them to combine with their husbands and to have an engineering team and a planning team and start putting together places. Okay, you got a young brother like Kaba said, he was on the Shark Tank. He invented a portable charging station that you can take with you, like Kaba was saying. Brother already invented it, called Spark, okay? And I was on LinkedIn, and a white dude who was into the field like we all are, he said, oh, that don't work. I said, I wrote quickly, you're wrong. Because what Kaba said, he can take that in his car. I can take that in a car. I ain't got to look for a charging station. I can go with this remote charger that this brother then invented and charge my car and keep grooving.
How long does it currently, how long does a charge hold, and how many miles does that mean?
Okay, it depends on your vehicle. So say you got a Tesla. We're going to start with them. Okay, a Tesla, they can go up to 300 to 400, 500 miles now they're putting cars at. Wow. So with a two-hour charge, they can recharge you back up to full charge of the 200 or 300 miles that the cars go. But is two companies called SK Industry, South Korean Innovation. They created a battery that could charge your car in 10 minutes to full charge, over 500 miles.
Damn.
There's a company in America called FreeWire. They got something called Boost. Boost, Britain just bought about 1,000 of them. So they can charge cars rapidly, keep cars moving, you know, doing the charging. Everybody over in Europe, they're getting rid of them combustions. They go on electric trucks, electric cars, all of that. They didn't already sign the ban on them.
Wow, that's crazy, man.
Yes,
Gabe Jabi, he says, I got a Ford Fusion, energy half gas, half electric. He fills his tank up. He fills the gas up every 4 months. Damn.
Yeah. Yeah, and see,
that's crazy, dude.
Man, I got the same kind of car.
What?
See, you don't even have to. This is what I'm talking about. You don't even have to charge the. He telling you, he don't even have to use gas.
Oh, man.
He can charge every day because the number of miles to his vehicle will be accommodating to his trips. Remember, I said vehicle trips. His mode of transportation is to go to home, to the store. Now, say he go to a mall, he can charge his car there now. Okay, 2 hours while he's shopping, he can charge his car. If you don't want to charge a full charge, you can charge it for an hour. He'll still have enough miles to get home.
So what is the cost for the charging? Like, especially on location, like, you know, at a mall or something like that. But what's the cost of the charge? Because some people are thinking, well, if I plug this into my house, is my electric bill going to, you know, skyrocket?
No, because this is the key. The charging station is an appliance. No different than your refrigerator or that Kenmore washer. We have one that lasts forever. Right. Okay? It's an appliance, brother. It ain't nothing. You know, you can put a 30-amp breaker in your box, your electric box, and direct connect the charger to it so you don't cause a fire, and then get a disconnect, and you're safe. The charger will come on. It's programmed. Plug it in. It'll come on. You can charge during non-peak hours, which is going to be from 12 to about 6 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
Plug it in when you go to bed, it'll come on whatever time you want. 3 o'clock in the morning, that's the cheapest kilowatt hour. You're only paying, what, 10 cents a kilowatt or maybe less.
Wow.
Okay, I go charge my car, it's only $7, $5, $12. I ain't paid $70 or $50 for no gas. See, that's the point.
And see, that's for right now. Because when you get deep in the future, you're dealing with Raw G.
There you go.
And Raji, you don't pay nothing.
Exactly.
Don't exist anymore. So you can charge whatever you want using solar power that will get that power there. The other piece I wanted to add to what Brother Carroll is saying is that when you talk about the portable one chargers that you can carry in your car, think in terms of, you know, like when you're driving and your battery dies, you know, they have that portable charger.
Yes.
They can get a jump. So with that in your car, that is what you would use to charge the car if you needed to. You could charge your car portably. But not just that. When you think about the gas that you have that you don't use because you're doing electric, think in terms of those little tubs that you have that you always fill up with gasoline.
Right.
You know, you put a couple gallons of gasoline in that little tub. You know, they say make sure that it's flat on the ground and all the rest of that when you're putting it in. Well, that extra stuff, in case you run out of gas, you have that as a backup.
Yes, you do.
It's going to come to a point in time where you're not even going to have gas. It's going to be just total electric.
Yeah, and
you're going to have backup batteries, backup chargers.
You're absolutely correct. The reason that the hybrid technology was created was because there wasn't enough charging stations available. So you can take your car and charge it. And when you go beyond, say the car only goes 40 miles or 30 miles, when you go beyond that charge, then the gasoline engine kicks in. There's two types, the mixing of electric and gas, and then the separation, which is like, I have a Chevy Volt. It's a fully electric vehicle, but it'll take gas. If I didn't want to put no gas in, I'd have to put no gas in it never. I can just run on
full. Oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know you could have the either or choice.
Oh, absolutely. That's why it's hybrid. It's hybrid. Okay. So, you know, and that was to get people introduced to the coming of the full electric car.
Now, somebody just said in the chat, that's some rich thinking here. Now, how some of us be messing around with that poverty consciousness. So let's talk about what are the costs of some of these cars? Because we're thinking, you know, $200,000, $300,000. What are these cars costing?
No, these cars are costing some car. It depends on what kind of car you get. Okay, now if you're fully electric, they have a Bolt, okay, which goes 300 and some miles on a charge. You got Teslas. These cars are costing from the low end, which is the Bolt, $33,000. They're gonna go down up to $40,000-$50,000. But that's where the money comes in. Now that the cars are new, they have grants, they have rebates. They have all these things that you can do to recover the cost of the car now. See, that's why that person is saying what it is. Ask them, do they own an electric car or do they want to get an electric car? I'm a retiree on a fixed income. I knew I couldn't keep fixing my old car all the time. Mm-hmm. So I went and got me an electric car and took advantage of all the rebates, all the tax incentives, all of that paid for my car.
Wow.
Money that I got back, I paid half of that I got back in rebates, pay for the car. That's what I call cost recovery. You can't go buy no Lexus or whatever. Soon as you drive it off, they ain't giving you a quarter. You go get an electric car, you got a $7,500 tax rebate with the feds, $2,500 with the state. There's nonprofits that will offer you $1,000 to $200,000, $500 just for buying the car. There is grants to get you the charging station, to install the charging station, to purchase. They will reimburse you once you spend your money for them. Okay, so you got to crawl before you walk. Ain't nothing going to be a lord for us. It's always going to be a high level for us to get in. Okay, I look at it this way. I could have went out and bought me a Lexus. I'd still be paying $700 for tune-ups. $1,000. Some people, I had a lady friend bought a Mercedes. She bought an insurance. So when she had to take it to the shop, the insurance would pay for the repair work. Okay? I take my electric car, I'm only paying $80, $20. Okay? I can live off of that.
I can afford that. Wow.
That's the point of it. How do you want to spend your money? How do you want to spend your money?
So let me tell the family. So the links are above. If you're on Facebook, family, you can get the book. I think it's $3.99. Download it. If you're on YouTube, the links are below in the description. And I also, I'm going to put the free e-course back in the chat for you so you can sign up to his free e-course, 5-day video e-course that he did a PowerPoint on. It's absolutely crazy. So there it is in there, fam. Go ahead, Baba Kaba. You were going to say something?
No, I wanted to ask, brother, in terms of what do you think the impact on insurance of the car would be?
Is electric. My insurance is, let's see, $225 a month. It could go even lower than that if I chose another provider.
Why would the insurance be less with electric than compared to gas? Because that ain't nowhere what I'm paying.
Yeah, see, that's what I'm saying. See, because the electric car doesn't have all of the bells and whistles that a combustible car has. That's the problem. So, and plus it's electric and it's incentivized to be cheaper so that people can purchase something.
Mm-hmm. Plus it's environmentally friendly, right? So
exactly. Plus, if you know, with insurance companies, your age, your driving record, you got a college degree, you got a good this, a good that, you can get all kind of bonus points for driving a car. So you can also lower your costs through your driving behavior, which is going to improve with the electric car because you still got the same pop, same speed as a combustible engine. You still got the fluidity that you like. You got the style. You got the class. You got everything that people look for in a car. But as we do know, people still want those gas cars.
Mm-hmm. It's psychological. It really is.
Yes, it is.
It is. You told me something else, too, that was fascinating. I shouldn't share this story. Jules and I were talking, and he was telling me about that, you know, electric cars have really crazy acceleration and can really take off because it's lighter, it's faster, and it has actually more power than, an engine car. So, you know, Kaba knows I have me and the goddess, we have a drop top BMW. So I went out and I was driving and I saw this brother with a Tesla and we at the stoplight, we looking at each other. You know, this was earlier in the summertime. I'm looking at him. He looking at me like, just like the commercial, you know? And I'm like, now I know the Beamer, that thing is a jet. It has crazy acceleration. Dude left my ass so quick. It was embarrassing as shit. I put the pedal to the floor. Shouldn't be saying this on air, you know, but I'm just saying it's like that changed me because there's a, for guys, there's a psychological factor that you want a fast car. You want to be able to move, you know, it's a cycle. When I saw that, I said, okay, Jules, all right, I'm in. You know, let me start researching and figuring this thing out. That was absolutely crazy to me.
Man, if you look at the book, Kaba was saying, man, the one thing I talk about is the driving experience.
Yeah.
That's what it's about. It's the driving experience of it. Okay, Kaba works with children. He works with elders. He works with community. And so when you're working with people, that's a lot of energy you giving the people.
Mm-hmm.
It requires a lot of energy because you're dealing with the whole diasporic epigenetics. You're dealing with all of them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He get an electric car. It's quiet. He going to be smooth. His whole energy level going to transform.
Because you got a really nice vehicle too, Baba Kaba.
You going to be comfortable.
Yeah. And I know Kaba loves to drive. I don't like to drive unless I have to. But then when I have to, I want to be able to jet and get in, get out, do what I got to do, get my maneuvers, bam, bam, bing, bang, and I'm in because I don't like to be around white people too long. It messes with my skin. So I'm just saying I gotta get in, you know. Right. But when I saw there was another brother who I follow, and I can't pronounce his name, but he's a brother who does tech reviews. And he bought a Tesla and he did a review on his car. I was blown away. I had no idea. I have to get out of this mindset of gas cars. I have to get out of this mindset when I think of an electric car and charging. I think of the Energizer Bunny. I think of, you know, like what happens when I drive and the damn thing goes out. You know, it's like, it's not that situation. You're not going to be in that situation. So this is why I'm so excited about having you on and why I pushed the hell out of you. So you being kind to me. I kind of went in on you, dude, because I'm like, look, man, I know the family needs this information. We need to get this done, dude, or you need to get this done.
It's true.
Because I knew the importance of it to the family, because once you see yourself in the future, then you're going to automatically create everything you need in the current to get there.
Yeah, future now, like Kaba said, future now.
Facts, facts.
Yeah. And also, like Kaba was saying, you know, even the electric car, I'm going to tell you why it's so else important. You got hydrogen cars, which can be produced by water, solar cars. But with the electric car, the electric charging station can become a power plant that can charge your whole house. So, or I should say electrify your home.
In
Japan, you can pull up your car and charge your vehicle and it'll turn on all your lights, everything that requires you to have electricity in your home, that it runs through the charging station.
Unbelievable.
The power of it. It's a great decarbonizer of this carbon footprint we're trying to lower.
Right.
Okay. And anything that deals with zero, as in your book, God, you do the equation, it comes out to infinity, right?
Right, got it, yep.
Same thing. Infinity.
Phenomenal.
That's what's up. So we're dealing with electricity, okay? They still telling you, wow, they built these pyramids over here. How come, you know, how could they see? These are electric generators. The top of them is 90 degrees angle of incident. It's to the sun, the moon, the sun, the equinox. Okay? This wasn't no coincidence. Orion's belt. The first star you get through is Corona Borealis. We got corona disease. Okay? It's all together. See, I wrote a poem when it came out called Wu3i. Get your globe out there, all your naysayers, and put a stream from the Temple of Karnak in Egypt and run the string through Wuhan. Okay? Corona Borealis, okay? You
know? Wow.
We can get into the context of it all. The key is with this car, do your research. Like you said, the naysayer, challenge, go do your research.
Naysayer. Like Kaba says, you know, don't believe a word I say. Go do the research. It's right there.
Naysayer.
You know, we ain't going to bring you no BS on this show. So,
brother, they got Google Voice. I'm in the libraries. I used to work in libraries. Google Voice. I read encyclopedias, studied them. That's your new encyclopedia, Google Voice. You can ask a question and it can lead you to other sources of information. That's the key to what we have in these phones and these voice automation situations that we can use in phones and computers. They can really get you anything you want to know about.
Well, the fact of the matter is, family, what you really want to know about, if you want to know about electric vehicles, if you want to know how to be a part of the future, how to collapse time, how to be timeless and buy our time back that was stolen from us, go and get the book, or at least sign up for the free e-course. Get the information and do the work. That's what this is all about. Baba Kaba, you want to close this out?
Brother, I just wanted to say that the last chapter of my book is exactly what we're talking about right now.
Yeah.
We have to get ready for the future.
Yes.
You know, I believe in culture. I really do. I believe culture is to a human what water is to a fish. You live in it, You exist in it. Everything you do within your cultural common sense. But this means nothing if we don't understand the future. It is not about the strongest survive or the survival of the fittest. The ones that survive are the ones that can adapt to the new ways.
Yes.
The earth is constantly changing and learning. But let me, from my own perspective, what we talked about this evening, I could project myself back to the Per-Unk with Imhotep of the Third Dynasty, and he was probably talking the same thing that we were talking tonight.
Absolutely. Because, you know, Imhotep is the brother, okay? He is the builder. But I like I always say, they talk about Imhotep, but they need to talk about Sechet too.
Yes, absolutely. And Preshet.
Sechet was the sister. She the one did the engineering of the pyramid. She the one placed the diagrams, the weights and the measures, and the true Maiat. She is the true Maiat.
That is it.
Wow.
This ain't new.
No, it's not.
What we're doing is going back to the future. And like I say with the slingshot, the purpose behind pulling that back is not to go back. It's to project in front.
Exactly.
So we have to understand the power of our ancestors that sat at the feet of nature. And nature taught them this. To have electricity, you must have magnetism. To have magnetism, you must have electricity. That is the balance. That is Maat.
That's it.
Electrical currents live for magnetic fields.
Yes, they do.
And magnetic fields live for electrical currents. It is a symbiotic relationship.
Yes,
our ancestors understood that. Brother Julian Carroll's book describes for the 2021 audience what our ancestors knew back then. What Dr. Ayibo talks about with Gagu is what they talked back then.
Yes.
What Brother Carroll is talking about now is what they talked about then. So what I say is Sankofa. Let's go back and fetch it.
Man, let's get it. And you know, like, hey, we don't even talk about the liftoff of Mount Zion, okay? It's out there. Okay.
Brother Julian, I want to, now that you have been properly introduced to the family, let's not make this a one-time event. Now we can have you come back and we can have deeper discussions and be part of some deeper and broader processes as we begin to develop this future. Brother, it's been an absolute honor working with you and introducing you to the community. I so appreciate you and your work. You are a futurist. Your work is important and necessary for us to move forward. Baba Kaba, you already know I just love you to pieces. So everybody knows that, you know. But sometimes you just got to say it. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, you do.
Every now and again, you got to let her know, yeah, you know, I kind of love you, dude. You know, so that being said, family, I love you too. Uncle Jav Saneb, we'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Hotep community.